face of my conscience.
April 28th, 2023.
Clear out all the old cobwebs.
If it's 8 o'clock on Saturday morning, it's time for This Week in Waukesha. I'm your host, Downtown Donnie Brown, coming to you live and local from the office of former Alderman Don Paul Brown, also known as the Walk Radio Studio here in the NAMI building at 217 Wisconsin Avenue, next door to Project Wis Hope and the world's greatest dentist, Dr. Kevin Kennedy, and right around the corner from Theodora Yeoman's Park, where we are proud to honor our suffragette heritage here in the Shaw. Before we introduce this morning's special guest, you know what? I just got a text. It's actually Saturday, April 29th. Yesterday was the 28th, so I wanted to see if you were listening. And yeah, well, it looks like I do have a listener there. It's also my youngest daughter's birthday, so I better not screw up the date. But before we introduce this morning's guest, I would like to start by congratulating Waukesha North Class of 2018 alumnus Will McDonald for being drafted in the first round of the NFL draft on Thursday night by the New York Jets. The 6'3", 239-pound linebacker set a school record 34 sacks at Iowa State. Congratulations to Will and the McDonald family. He is the first Waukesha North grad to be selected in the first round ever and the first North Star to be taken in the NFL draft since my classmate Kurt Larson was drafted by the Colts in 1989 out of Michigan State. So, and a big shout-out to Cyclone Mike Schulte, an Iowa State alumnus and South Dad who must be thrilled about another Cyclone going to the show. So, on to the show. Romance, suspense, and a dash of humor is a great way to describe this morning's guest. You may know her very well from the Waukesha Farmer's Market, which she's been exhibiting for many years. Waukesha, please say good morning to Sarah, the author. Sarah, how are you?
I'm great. I'm so excited to be here.
Fantastic. So we know from your bio, you're a mom, a volunteer, and an author. You love the Packers, coffee, which is great because we're here having coffee together.
Coffee all day.
Pinot Noir. Mm-hmm. And Rick Springfield's music.
Yes.
Tell us about your books.
I started out writing romance.
Nice.
I never intended to be a romance author, but okay, it just kind of happened. I fell into it. And so my first book is a romantic comedy. After that, I wrote what I call a universe. So I have a series of five books that are more of a universe. They're all loosely linked together.
Very cool.
That's kind of set in a fictional town in Door County.
Nice.
Then I have a four-book Christian fiction cozy mystery that's set all over Wisconsin, primarily here in Waukesha.
Excellent.
And I just this year released my very first cozy mystery set in northern Wisconsin where a premenopausal woman is the star of the show.
Love it.
So that's what I'm going to be releasing at the farmer's market this year. And I wrote a cookbook.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Wow.
Is there to cook.
Okay. So a cookbook for those who hate to cook.
It's actually a cookbook for people who would rather be watching TV than cooking.
I love it. And so there's some pretty good little like kind of life hacks for cooking.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shop at Quick Trip.
Okay.
Shop at Quick Trip. I get all of my taco meat, my spaghetti meat, and my sloppy Joe meat from Quick Trip.
Really?
Yep.
Okay. Some very good insights. Yeah. Now that's a book you could use for most of us that are hooked on TV and modern electronics and digital, and so
frees up so much time.
Much fun. And what's the name of the cookbook?
It's Sarah's Cookbook for Humans Who Would Rather Be Watching TV Than Cooking.
Terrific. And so I imagine that'll be on prime display at the farmer's market.
Oh, yes.
Which opens next Saturday.
Next Saturday, April 6th.
Are you excited?
I am.
May 6th.
May 6th.
You're like me. We're getting the dates wrong. So now you just did that to save me, to make me feel better. Thank you so much. So,
yes.
Yeah.
May 6th.
So that's great. And the market, it's under new management this year.
It is.
So everything's, the transition's been pretty smooth so far?
I think so. We had the vendor meeting this past week.
Okay.
For the shopper, the market, you're not going to see a lot of differences. I know that the garbage issue is going to be addressed.
Sure.
And the porta potties are going to be maintained a little more closely. But I think that by and large, the average person coming to the market isn't going to notice a big difference.
Okay.
We're still in the Waukesha State Bank parking lot. And hopefully now they're saying that the construction with the apartment building next door is going to be done sometime the end of May. So fingers crossed.
That would be timely if they could do that.
Yeah, that'd be great.
And I know there's no guarantees when it comes to construction schedules.
But we're really hoping that that's done because then we get the full market space back.
Okay. So we Walk Radio will again for the second year be exhibiting at the farmer's market. Our good friend Johnny Watermelon will be there manning it as well as we're still looking to recruit a few hopefuls. So if you know of anyone that's looking for a good little side gig, especially any young students, you know, give us a shout here at the studio. 844-967-2789, or even just walk in here to the office of former Alderman Don Brown and ask for Johnny Watermelon, and we'd love to hear from you. But, yeah, we're excited about being back, and I want to welcome for the first year Alaska Fresh Salmon, which is they exhibit at West Bend's Farmers Market in Oconomowocs. They were not, under previous management, they weren't allowed into the Waukesha Farmers Market because their products weren't local enough. They get their salmon from artisanal fisheries in Alaska. People, you're talking generations of family fishers, and really neat, very entrenched relationships that nobody else has anywhere in this region. So you're able to get direct to consumer, right out of the water, just delicious salmon products. So we're really excited that they will be there. The owners, Adra Kusnirova and her husband, Juroz, where my guest last July, we did a recorded show while I was traveling, and I think they got a great concept. And I think we should honor those people in the blue proteins at our farmers market because they're farmers too.
Absolutely.
Especially as aquaculture is taking off and sustainable aquaculture is taking off. And yes, this is a shameless plug for one of my missions I'm involved in, which is the Center for Responsible Seafood. And people should learn more about what seafood could do for a healthier planet as well as for healthier humans. And we do have food insecurity issues right here in our own backyard. So pay attention. But so you mentioned Waukesha.
Yes.
Has been utilized or as part of your storyline in many of your books. And so would you say with the rich history we have here and with everything going on, especially as a university city, it does make a good backdrop or there's great material for your storylines?
I think so, especially the downtown area. We have a lot of quirky and recognizable spaces down here that have been fun to write about.
Right, absolutely.
I use the parking garage here in downtown as one of my locations.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So it's a very, if you're from here, you're going to recognize the spaces. If you're not from here, you can say, wow, that's kind of a cool town. I should check it out.
And some of the restaurants here have been involved in your stories because you're a big foodie, as you mentioned. So like myself.
Foodie. Yes. So. Yeah, the Rochester Deli, home of the greatest Reuben sandwich ever.
Really?
Yes.
Okay, I'm a fan of their pastrami and rye. I'll have to try the Reuben.
Their Reuben is amazing.
Nice.
And then, of course, Golden Chicken, who I'm pretty sure
Barry and Kim Bloom, my old neighbors.
If I don't order from Golden Chicken once a week, they're worried about me. So. Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's terrific. So very neat. Well, and gosh, like after a busy day at the farmer's market, that's an easy stop for you on the way back home, right?
If it is.
That's been an option in the past?
It is, but I utilize their delivery a little bit more.
Yeah, that is handy when they can show up. Yeah, and it's great. Like, and it's one of their children delivering it too because we know them. We go back many years with them. So a couple weeks ago, I had Shannon Ishizaki on from Orange Hat Publishing and 1016 Press, independent publisher, and you are self-published.
Oh, yeah.
And this is also National Libraries Week, I believe, and so I have to give a shout-out to our libraries. Bruce Gay is our director, has been on the show. We're trying to get him back or perhaps another one of the librarians.
We have a beautiful library.
We do.
We really do.
Yeah, you know, and it's been a year since the library renovation was completed, with many new spaces to check out, including a maker space and a demonstration kitchen. Mm-hmm. Perhaps that would be a great little spot for your cookbook to show off, you know. So, but since the new programming and everything was put in a 22 place, they've circulated 938,080 items.
Wow.
They've had 200, almost 300,000 people visit the library. They've held 645 programs with almost 36,000 people attending. So big shout out to Bruce Gay and his team at our libraries. And is it safe to say that we've got a great, we do have a voracious reading community here, as well as a good storytellers tradition?
We do. We have in Waukesha a tremendous dedication to reading. I love going to the farmer's market and talking to people about what they're reading, what they're interested in. And it's also fun. A lot of people come up to me and say, I've got a story to tell. How do I go about writing it?
Yes.
And I think a Saturday doesn't go by, I don't have somebody coming up and saying, I want to write a book. I want to write a story. How do I do it?
Yeah. And I'm in that same camp. So I need to put some more pressure on myself. And I've got a ton of great stories in my mind, too. And I remember I was friends. I lived in D.C. for a short time. And I was neighbors with an author named William Joyce, who had some good titles published. And he used to say that everybody has at least one great story in them.
And that's true. That's true. And the first step is just put it down. Just write it. It doesn't matter. This is what I tell all young writers. It doesn't matter what you think it sounds like. Just get it down on paper.
Yeah. You've probably heard of Anne Lamott. She had a great book about it. And her first advice was to write a piece of S-H-I. You know, like that was... write a S word first draft.
Yes. Yeah.
And
we
she's
call
absolutely
it,
right.
I call it vomiting out the first draft.
Yes.
Just get it out. It does not have to be perfect. It doesn't have to be anything. Just get it out. And
you
then
bet.
You have your structure, and now you can build around your structure.
Terrific. So when we come back, Sarah the author is going to talk specifically about some of her recent titles, as well as some other great stories at the farmer's market and what we can look for in this year's offering. When This Week in Waukesha continues. And don't forget, my guest on May 6th next week is our defending state champions esports team from Waukesha South. So lots to look forward to. And then Karen Treadwell, Waukesha County Food Bank, is on the 13th. So This Week in Waukesha continues with Sarah the author.
Work all night and I drink a rum.
Daylight come and me wanna go home.
Stack banana till the morning come.
Hey, we're back This Week in Waukesha, and that is my ode to Harry Belafonte, who passed away this week. And I believe it's one of the highlights of his career was being a guest on The Muppets. You know, they used to say in the 80s, a band's coming out party was, or when they made the big time, was when they were on David Letterman. When Letterman was on NBC. In the 70s, it was being on The Muppet Show in the mid to late 70s. And that was always a great great rendition of the legendary Banana Boat song. And so we all believe, you know, I believe certainly Harry Belafonte will certainly be missed, but the music lives on. And talking about living on with all the great stories that Sarah the author has to share, we're going to talk about some of her latest titles that she wants to promote, in addition to the cookbook for people who'd rather watch TV, and also some great stories at the farmer's market that I'm dying to talk about. And am I forgetting something, Anastasia?
You know, Don, you're talking about all these stories, but you're leaving out the story of Clara Jelasic, maybe the best story we have this weekend.
Thank you, Anastasia, and I am embarrassed because that should be a household name in Waukesha. Clara Jelasic may go down as one of the best Division III lacrosse players in this region ever. She has already broken the all-time Division III record for one category, ground balls, and she's top 25 in three other categories, including goals. Carroll University women's lacrosse team plays in the CCIW tournament semifinals Wednesday, May 3rd at Carroll at 6 p.m. So put that on your calendar. That's an exciting moment. I'm going to try to check it out. I might even blow off my son's baseball game if they're playing that night, and I think he would certainly understand. So another great story, and we're going to try to get Clara and her coach on the show hopefully later this month. I'm working with Carroll Athletics because that is a fantastic story. She scored like 7 goals against Elmhurst in a game on April 12th, and I forgot to mention that on the show. And Carroll's been great. Athletic department sending over press releases, but I was having some problems with my business email. Now that I've got a civic media email, we're fixing that with Carol, so we'll be able to report more news. But hey, I also want to give a shout out to Carol freshman Andrew LaBelle, was named the men's tennis second team all conference. He's from Iguanago High School, and he's the top player at Carol, along with his twin brother Ryan, who's a very close second, and their sister Ashley also played for the women's tennis team there too. So great family connection there with Carol. Go Pios. So do you have is Carol part of any of your storylines at all, Sarah, or have there been any have you taken advantage of some of the great resources they have there?
Not to date, but okay. You know, I'm still early on in my career writing. So.
Sounds great. Okay. Yeah. No, there's some I've heard some interesting stories there from Carol's history. So I think there could be, and if you like historic fiction like I do, I think there could be some good material.
I love historic fiction. But here's the thing, and I get asked about this all the time. I'm too lazy to write historic fiction. Because
you might as well be writing biographically.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah,
it's a lot. A lot of research about just the smallest things.
Yeah,
I have a friend who came out with a novel a number of years ago that was set in the week following the Titanic disaster. Set in New York City, the week following Titanic. And she had to research right down to, were Oreo cookies a thing?
Yeah.
In that time. And the short answer is yes.
Okay.
But it took her, even with the internet, it took her a while. And I'm thinking, I don't have that kind of time or energy to be, figuring out what kind of
bustle. I like the detective part of it.
Or whatever.
Yeah, because I'm working on a historic fiction concept for way too long. But I do like the detective part of it. But absolutely right. It is very, very time consuming. So, but back to, what are some other recent titles you have published that you'll be promoting at the farmer's market?
Well, my newest one that I just came out with is called Abracadabra.
Nice.
It is the first in my new cozy mystery series.
Okay.
The main character is a woman named Max Marchino, and it's not short for Maxine or anything like that. She's actually named after Max McGee.
Love it.
That's her middle name is McGee. Her father...
The tight end for the Packers.
Tight end for the Packers.
Had that big Super Bowl hungover and scored like 2 touchdowns.
Yes, that's the one.
Love it.
She is the 5th of 5 daughters. Her mother wanted to have another child, and her father said, "The only way I'm having it is if we have a boy." And out came another girl.
So I've heard quite a few stories like that. Yeah.
So he raised her as a boy. So Max is kind of interesting in that she is an expert marksman with a bow and arrow and a crossbow, and that does come into play with this first mystery that she solves.
What a great character.
And an
important lesson, if you're not the starter on the team, go out and get really drunk the night before. And nothing's better for a hangover than all that pressure on you. You got to come in and you got to play and you got 100. That's really, and now he's like, he's part of the Packer mythology, probably as much as Bart Starr or Jerry Kramer.
Yep, he is a hero and a legend.
Love it.
And now... a main character in a woman's cozy novel. So,
you think there'll ever be a story, a book from Sarah the author surrounding the Waukesha Farmer's Market? Any?
I am toying with the idea of like the Farmer's Market Mysteries or something like that because it's a fascinating place.
It really is.
If you're there for more than just your casual shop.
So many interesting characters.
Very much so.
And great, you know, and family businesses. So a lot of like really great stories. And that's one of the things I enjoyed about exhibiting there with Johnny and Walk Radio at the first meeting a lot of the different exhibitors, as well as the shoppers themselves.
Oh, the shoppers are fun.
They love, you know, yeah. So I think there's a treasure of great stories coming out of our farmers markets.
One of the upsides to my booth is that I'm not, because I'm not selling like beets and onions, it's not as crazy busy.
Yeah.
And so people do come and they spend some time to talk.
That's terrific.
It's fascinating.
So when we come back from the break, we want to hear more about these stories that you hear at the farmers market with Sarah, the author, as This Week in Waukesha continues. Don't go away. This Week in Waukesha, and that's a cracker with one of my favorite songs from the 90s, and it goes out especially to our youngest child, our daughter Kiara, who turns, depending on how you pronounce it, who turns 13 today.
Happy birthday.
And my wife Melissa, who also had a birthday on Wednesday, so a lot of birthdays at the Brown household, and Kiara's supposed to be awake by now because Melissa said she'd wake her up so we could sing that song to her.
Oh, but this is so early.
It's so early. And, well, weather permitting, she's got a lot of softball today. Two games at a tournament in Kenosha. And then there's like an unlimited program she does at the OAW facility, which is a lot of fun on Saturday evenings. And tonight's the last offering of that. So it's going to be a great birthday for her. But if the weather dictates otherwise, we may do some movies or some other kind of fun birthday things. So
see, now that's my speed.
Yeah, so she was, we love all of our children, but especially, you know, she certainly was, she was unexpected and has really just been a joy and just made so many things possible for us. So we're so glad she's in the world and celebrating life as a teenager. So we were talking before the break with Sarah, the author, about all the great stories that could come from the farmer's market. And she's toyed with the idea of like a farmer's market story series. And in addition to the exhibitors, there's a lot of the people that come by. And Sarah was mentioning that because she's not selling produce and is, you know, constantly busy, she gets people that come by and they take time to tell their stories. What have you heard? What have been some of the more interesting tidbits?
I have a young lady who stops by, and she always has a pet with her.
Nice.
She either has a kitty in a backpack, or one time she had a lizard on her shoulder.
Okay. It's not Alicia Halbert's slave in the Alder, right?
Mm-mm, no.
She brings her kitty in a special kitty buggy or a stroller.
This is kitty in a backpack.
Yeah. She might be calling in today, too, to promote the farmer's market and to wish you well. So, but I'm sorry. Go ahead. Continue.
Yeah. And she is... She is always coming in. She works, I believe, for like a nursing home or an assisted living.
Neat.
So, you know, a lot of talking about not like specifics about her patients, but just when you're in contact with people like that, your life is a little more interesting than if you're just working in an office.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. So, and speaking of pets, tomorrow I just learned from our civic media communications department, if you will, that tomorrow, Sunday, April 30th, is National Pet Parents Day.
Woohoo!
And Sarah has revealed that she is the proud mother of four cats.
I have four cats. I have had as many as five.
Yep.
Not that I'm a crazy cat lady.
Sure.
It just kind of happened that way.
Yep.
We wanted a dog.
Okay.
But we couldn't find a dog that the family could agree on.
Okay.
You know, we went to Haws and just could not find the right dog. So our daughter, our youngest child, wanted a pet. So, all right, let's get her a kitten. Well, here's the thing about kittens. If they don't have other kittens to play with,
yeah,
they will go crazy just like attacking you.
Yeah.
Like your ankles. We all walked around that summer with scratches on our ankles because Jasper kept getting after us. Uh-huh. So then our son said, well, if if Hannah gets a cat, then I should have a cat.
Yeah.
All right, well, go get a cat. Well, Peter went down to Hawes on buy one, get one free kitten day. And then we went from having one to having three.
Right.
And then my husband called from work one day and said, I have this lady, she's moving into an apartment, she has to get rid of her cat. What do you think? And at that point, you have three or you have four. What does it matter? So what's one more, right?
Right.
But I did not, let the record show, bring any of these animals into my house.
Yeah.
So.
Good deal. So but I learned from the information from Civic Media that nearly three quarters, 72% of Americans are pet parents. And I would imagine those statistics are consistent here in Waukesha.
Oh, for sure.
So.
Just look at the number of dogs that come to the market.
Yeah. You know, that could be a subject for another show because as alderman, I learned there were some of the pet ordinances aren't necessarily pet parent friendly. So I'm glad we're talking about this. But let's hear more stories about the farmer's market that you've come across. How about some of the exhibitors you might have met?
Oh, well, we got to talk about Ricky with Mommy Feliz Tacos. First of all, and I am not a paid spokesperson, best tacos in Waukesha.
Really?
I say that unreservedly.
Ricky, and is he from one of the restaurants here, or is just like a food truck?
Mommy Feliz is his food truck. He started out working, I want to say for Chef Jack, but he'll probably laugh at me because that's probably wrong.
Sure.
But he is just, he's a good, I can say kid because I'm old.
Yeah.
He's a good kid.
Love
he
it.
Has the best tacos and the biggest, brightest smile you're going to see anywhere.
I think I met. Yeah, he's a really nice guy too, because his stand was near ours.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. It's
you know,
same.
I think I only had one because his line. There's always a line going to the beginning.
Always
so
a line
that's why
for
I
him.
Haven't really had too many of his tacos. So, but
get there early.
I think he's got close competition because at Frame Park when Waukesha South is playing, one of the Waukesha South dads, Jared Dable, who's been on the show before, he brings in a guy named Juan who's got a kind of a food truck at Metal Tech where Jared works. And now he's at the South games and he's, I got a steak burrito last night. I had the other half.
Steak burrito.
For breakfast this morning. Yeah. So, look out for Juan at the South games. South has had a tough week. They started out great with a 3-2 victory behind stellar pitching from Tannis Lang on Monday, 3-2 over Waukesha West. Unfortunately, we lost to Waukesha. That was at West. We lost to West 14-5 on Wednesday night at Frame. And then last night, just, the wheels came off early, and we lost a tough one to non-conference rival West Allis Ale, 17-0. And so tough week for the Black Shirts. But weather permitting, they'll be back at it today in a doubleheader at Maguanago. And so we wish the Black Shirts well. And trying to get some updates on Waukesha North baseball and Coach Don Radomski. I haven't heard anything from their communications department, so I'll have to work on that. I met Carl Anderson a few months ago at a hockey game, the AD at North. So I will do a better job of talk about all the great things there, especially with the glad tidings with Will McDonald being drafted in the first round. So,
that is so cool.
Got to celebrate the North Star Pride, too. So,
Wisconsin kid gets to play with Aaron Rodgers in the weirdest
possible
way.
That's what he said.
Not
a huge Packers fan, but a big Rodgers fan. Yeah. So, and it's too bad it's he's playing for the evil New York Jets, but, you know, that's me being a Bills fan. So, so what else is I want to, before I forget, too, that May 8th through 12th is Teacher Appreciation Week, so put that in your calendars. And May 6th, my guest is the Waukesha South esports team, who have won their second state title in a row.
Woo-hoo.
And they'll be here at the show along with their coach, math teacher, Andrew Yep, Waukesha South, excellent teacher. So we'll certainly be acknowledging him and all the other great faculty. And any teachers in your stories, Sarah? There has to be, I would think.
Yes, actually, I was a teacher.
Okay.
I was raised by teachers, so of course teachers have to feature.
And
somewhere.
You didn't teach home ec, right?
I did not. No, I touched. I touched primary school. So
love it.
The wee little ones.
And they got great stories.
Oh my goodness! I taught in a school just outside of Detroit.
Oh, whereabouts?
Not Livonia. Well, I lived in
Livonia. Okay.
But the school was in Redford, which
Redford.
Is
oh yeah,
like a little tiny strip.
Home of Catholic
Livonia.
Central High School, right?
There you go.
Yep.
There
sure.
you go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Our little parochial school shared a parking lot with a country club, which sounds way fancier than it is.
Sure.
but it was a two-room school. That makes me sound really old. Yeah, yes, back in my day, we had two rooms. I was a two-room school, and my roommate and I were the two teachers.
Nice.
It was K to six.
Okay.
So I had K to three.
Yeah.
In mine. And we were given a lot of opportunity to, you know, being a parochial school, you're talking about, well, we're ministering, you know, the gospel and, and that. But we were able to minister in a very practical way because a lot of these kids would show up without proper winter wear or without having had breakfast or, you know, and that was my first job right out of college. So I'm 21 years old.
Sure.
I know nothing about anything.
Right.
But when you're 21, you think you know everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And here I was faced with real issues like inner city hunger and poverty and what people would do to keep themselves afloat.
Sure.
Which was amazing.
Those are, yeah, and those are stories that are worth reading, should be read, should be written about, and should be read. So
someday I'll get there. But I do, my second novel was based around parochial school teachers. And that's Lies and Chance. And
that's a great name.
That is a, I don't know if you want to call it a murder mystery, romantic suspense.
There you go.
What have you.
Sure.
That is my...
Okay.
My favorite book, which I'm not supposed to have favorites, but that's my
favorite. But I want to learn more about Max Marcino, too, with that coming out. And so, and did you say you had another book? I don't know if we got to that. There was another one you were promoting. Is that
just a cookbook? Did I miss that?
The cookbook.
Well, I mean, I'm promoting
not just
all
a cookbook.
It's the cookbook.
Yeah, a large percentage, probably the same percentage of pet parents are not real, would rather, you know, would rather be watching TV than cooking.
Absolutely.
So I know how tough that is. And hey, before I forget, here in the office of former Alderman Don Paul Brown, James Centel has just checked in. His show, Morning Cannolis, is next. So the morning continues here from the office of former Alderman Don Paul Brown, also known as the Walk Radio Studio. So stick around for Jim's show. He's got a lot to talk about, especially with some of the developments going on at the state and federal level with our legislatures. So do you write any politics in any of your stories,
oh,
sir?
Oh, heavens no. No,
that's
no,
where
no,
you draw
no.
the line.
Yep. I tell people I'm not here to change the world. I write to entertain.
Sure.
We have enough people writing nonfiction, political, all of that.
Yeah.
I write good versus evil, love conquers all.
Sure.
And throw in a few laughs along the way.
Sure. And no metaphoric references that are political then or that people could read into. Okay.
No, not even.
Just telling it like it is.
Not even a tiny little bit. No.
Yeah. So I imagine that 'cause I remember people would like, there are people that read Mark Twain and they think, well, this was a metaphor for this and that and this and really, he was just recording what he was seeing, like a lot of good authors. And
sometimes the curtains are just blue because the curtains are blue.
And maybe it's a hidden message that they were subconscious messaging, but it's a lot of times you're reporting and putting your own interpretation on it with the beauty of words. So
yes,
nice. So do you have time while you're there to kind of venture around the farmer's market? Do you have someone that attends the booth with you, or you're kind of there? Or maybe it's before and after is when you really get to know the vendors.
I do a little walking around before and after. I am fortunate to have a partner, Emily.
Emily.
Who is everything Emily Studio. She makes fantastic earrings out of clay.
Oh, neat. So you let her display her wares
Absolutely.
There. Oh, that's really great.
Yep. We split time. Sometimes she's there by herself.
All right.
And sometimes I'm there by myself. It just depends on our schedule. You know,
sure.
Every Saturday from May 6th to the end of October is a lot.
Okay.
It's a long season, so... And sometimes the weather doesn't cooperate. Books and books and rain, not always the greatest thing together, so...
So, but you have a canopy, right?
We do.
That
oh,
helps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
just, but yeah, I know when you get that eastern or western... Yeah, so... I get you.
When it's windy, it's just everybody has a kite. A big, giant kite.
Yeah.
So... Note to vendors, weigh down your tents.
And I guess that's kind of the advantage I have as a show person, and I'm using my own laptop. If it's raining, it's like, no, I'm going to do the show at the studio, and we'll come back and help Johnny after the show.
There you go. Yep.
Because, it's just not worth that risk. My whole life is in that laptop with my business. Yep. And so
can't lose it. Can't
you cannot lose it. Lose it. Yeah. No. So how many years have you been doing the farmer's market now?
I think this is going to be my ninth.
Ninth year. That's amazing. Yes. So you've got some great ideas then about how to shop the farm. You must have some great tips.
Oh, well, here's what you do. First of all, get there early.
Okay.
Get there very early when the vendors are fresh.
Yep.
And you have the biggest selection of everything, and you get a parking space close.
I love it. So let's put a pin in that. We're about to go to a break. When we come back, we want to hear some more tips from Sarah, the author, for shopping the farmer's market. Is maybe some tips for aspiring writers when This Week in Waukesha continues. And don't forget, my guest next week is the Waukesha Southeast sports team celebrating its second state title. Don't go away with Sarah, the author. This Week in Waukesha continues.
Falling and I'm running out of breath. Keep me in your heart for a while.
Hey, we're back This Week in Waukesha, Saturday, April 29th. And as many of you regular listeners have known, the last couple months I've been really promoting Warren Zevon's nomination to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and to safeguard that, to get him in, there was a voting process, and you could vote every day, once a day, up until yesterday, April 28th. And I want to thank so many who have turned out. I haven't checked the latest standings, the final standings, but it seemed like he was in a pretty secure place in third place behind Cyndi Lauper and George Michael. Go figure. Yeah. And
how is he not already in?
Well, I guess there was an editor for Rolling Stone magazine that just had a real whinge about it, just didn't like him, and was always played a very influential role in keeping him out. And I think years of pressure and having big fans like Bruce Springsteen and Eddie Vedder, I think it finally compelled the committee or those in charge to say, you know, this guy really deserves a real look. And his first year, I believe, of being, you know, part of the, he's finished third out of five. They take five every year. And so it looks like he's in a pretty secure place, like about 20,000 votes ahead of Iron Maiden. You know, I'll have to check that again. And maybe if time allows, we'll take a look here. Or maybe Anastasia might be able to look. It's vote.rockhall.com, and they show the standings. And a favorite artist of many of my siblings, and I was influenced by that and got to listen to a lot of Warren Zevon, and he certainly deserves a great place. And that song you hear, Keep Me in Your Heart, was like one of his, I believe, his very last recording before he succumbed to cancer in the early aughts. And it's very, you know, heartfelt song. And I want to thank all of you for keeping Warren Zevon in your hearts, and hopefully we'll be able to celebrate his inauguration, if you will, into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame later this summer. So stay tuned. But in the meantime, Sarah, the author's here, getting ready to inaugurate our, I forget what year it is, it might be like the 63rd or 4th offering of our Waukesha Farmers Market, maybe longer. And she's been a part. Would you say that you are offering produce for the soul with your books, with your writing?
Yes, I love that. I love having it put that way.
Yeah. So, because it's, you go to a farm, I mean, farmers markets traditionally were that produce, fruit, whatever was local and fresh. And it's, they've since evolved into more of like a bizarre concept where you
can go and you get
some different types of proteins, including Alaska Fresh. I'm really excited they're being, and if you love salmon, you really owe it to yourselves to check, because this comes right out of the Alaskan waters and goes through very few hands. And the Kusnir Rove has actually worked for some of those artisanal fisheries, especially the husband, Juroz. He used to come from his, I forget what country he was from in Eastern Europe, but that's how he spent his summers. That's how he would work. And that's a great story. You'll have to meet them. I know they're manning the other farmers markets, but they have two younger people. I promised Adra we'd look after them and introduce ourselves. But hopefully we'll get her and her husband and their newborn to spend a Saturday with us at the farmer's market. So check that out. And so many other great ones. You know, we were talking about the Belgian waffle.
It's
been there for quite a while.
Yep.
And
the ultimate street food. You can smell them before you see them.
Yeah, no doubt. And you said Freddie's, what's the name of his food truck? The taco
Mommy
guy?
Felice.
Ricky's.
Ricky's
Mommy Felice.
Mommy Felice. You can't miss, it's the most just, yeah, beautiful food truck.
And there's some Asian food there. And so
the egg rolls are amazing.
And I think Elegant Farmer still have a stand there?
They haven't.
Or has it been a while?
They haven't in a couple of years.
Okay, you're right.
It's been a couple of years.
Yeah.
COVID.
Yeah, so
we've had a little bit of a change. You know, COVID changed a lot.
It sure did, yeah.
For people. I know last summer we had an Italian place where you could get some good Italian food.
Okay.
You can get almost anything at the farmer's market now.
And the cheeses are well represented.
Cheeses are very well represented. The people that I share airspace with, honeybee artisans.
Oh, yeah.
Scott and Linda, they do, first of all, their honey is amazing.
Okay.
And they make homemade soaps, which are, they wind up in as stocking stuffers for Christmas at my house every year.
Nice. Oh, that's good to know.
And we'd like to encourage Linda to bring out her glass art a little more often. She does some
I love glass art.
In glass that is just gorgeous.
Sure.
But there are a number of people. We've got jewelry down there. There were last year 4 separate coffee places.
Wow.
So if you are a coffee drinker.
Now say that might not be enough.
Yeah, if you're a coffee drinker, you can get a coffee at each one of the corners.
I remember the one place right across from us was never open early. Or like while everyone was setting up, and there was such an opportunity to make money off of all the vendors, and they
just didn't get it together. Come on.
Like it's just one guy was just kind of cold about it. And but that would have been a huge money-making opportunity because people would say, don't bother making your own coffee or going by a steaming cup or one of the other places. Show up at the farmer's market while you're setting up and send someone over some money and we'll bring back a cart of coffee.
Yeah, just set up a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
I know that this year they are very serious about the vendors being in by 7:15. No later than 7:30, which means the bulk of us are going to be set up and ready to go by 7:30.
Good.
So if you get there early, you've got a good selection.
And that's one of the great tips. It's like you said, because they technically it starts at 8, but you can get there earlier.
You can get there early.
Yes.
Yep. And Most of us are set up and ready to go.
And that's where you're going to get the best produce. And I used to work with a chef in Chicago. He'd get there at 6 in the morning, and he'd get the freshest produce. And kind of stuff, too, that would be gone by the time you got there at 8 or 9.
Some of this stuff does sell out.
Because it sells out, yeah.
You know, especially if you're looking for a specialty item. I know morel mushrooms in the early part of May, that's a very short season.
Yeah. Them and
very
like the sugar snap
season.
Peas, I think, right?
Yep.
Yep.
And if you are going to get one of those specialty items, get there early because they do, stuff sells out.
Okay. Does your cookbook have some recipes for those items?
I don't have a morel mushroom.
Okay.
I'm afraid to cook those because they're such a delicacy and they're so expensive. Like, I don't.
And you can eat them raw, right?
You can eat them raw. My husband will bread them and saute them. And amazing.
Oh,
like
I bet. Yeah.
You put them in a risotto, which is,
My wife just found a great recipe for risotto. Talk about a food hack. And it's substituting rice for risotto, but you wouldn't know the difference. So great. So.
Yeah.
We'll have to throw some mushrooms in there from the farmer's market.
My husband is the cook. He's the chef in the house. I am the Monday through Friday. This is what we're having. Tuesday night's always tacos.
Nice.
And it's always Quick Trip taco meat.
Yeah.
There it is. Here's a vat of it. Throw it on a shelf.
You know, Quick Trip better throw you some quan for promoting them in your cookbook.
Not a paid spokesperson, but
you know, they should... They should do something nice for you, for sure. So, especially if it brings more customers in. So, hey, in the final minute we have here, Sarah, any advice for aspiring writers?
Just start. Look around your community. See if you've got a writer's group. I've been writing since I was 13. But I didn't get serious about it until I got into a writer's group that was here at Waukesha Park and Rec.
Okay.
They offered a writer's group.
That's right.
And Kathy and Michael Giorgio, who now own All Writers Studio here in downtown Waukesha, they still do what they call their Wednesday night group.
Love it.
I would love it if, you know, the Waukesha Park and Rec would offer.
Well, Mary Berg's my guest on May 20th from Parks and Rec. And to learn more about writing and just produce for the soul, go see Sarah the author at the Waukesha Farmers Market, which opens next Saturday.
Next Saturday.
Waukesha Esports is my guest. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Safety is everyone's responsibility, and see ya!